Welcome back to the album in our YouTube channel, the home of album reviews, discography guides and think pieces. So today's review is a review of the brand new self-titled debut album from the supergroup House of All. And the only way I can really start this review is by talking about The Fall. Now you guys know The Fall, I've covered them pretty extensively on this channel, and the videos did quite well thanks to some, doing the Twitter rounds and what have you. So, you know, when I heard about the prospect of a Fall supergroup forming, I was like, yes please. And it's true that there have been many attempts at kind of Fall supergroup like things in the past, whether it's like Blue Orchids with Martin Bramah and Una Baines, or Brix and the Extricated with obviously Brix Smith, the Hanley brothers and Steve Trafford. You know, there's been a couple other kind of iterations of stuff like that, but this one definitely seemed to be the most definitive, because if you take one look at the lineup of this group, they've essentially brought together like the Fall Avengers, if you like. Like, they've got Martin Bramah of Blue Orchids, founding member of the Fall, guitarist, once described as the only equal to Marky Smith in the group ever. And then you've got Steve Hanley on bass, the longest serving Fall member apart from Marky Smith, his brother Paul Hanley on drums, but also joined on double drums by Mr. Simon Wolsencroft, who served a tenure in the mid to late 80s and early 90s, I think, all the way through to the mid 90s, if I remember correctly. He's a fantastic drummer, no doubt about that. And then you've got Mr. Pete Greenway on second guitar, the Fall's last guitarist, and definitely has some brilliant stuff up his sleeve, in my opinion. So, like, apart from maybe some absences like Craig Scanlon or maybe Eleni Pulu, they've essentially brought together the Fall equivalent of the Avengers on this album. So this couldn't not be great, is what I thought initially. Although, I suppose the question is, what case would they be able to make for their own originality on this album? Because obviously, being that it's a Fall-based supergroup, they may end up being kind of, you know, typecast as, like, oh, it just sounds like The Fall, they're just doing The Fall version 2, what have you, what have you. So I hope that it wasn't just going to be like a complete cut and paste of The Fall sound, which I know is very iconic, but I suppose if you've been in the group, you kind of have that mindset still instilled in you. So, you know, maybe they might get typecast in that way, but I hope they would be able to find a glimpse of their own originality in here, because the guys are all very competent musicians, so I hoped that they would be able to come up with something that was pretty damn good, and by all means, they should have no reason not to. So after a good few listens, here's what I thought of the brand new self-titled album from House of All. The opening track is called Ainbite and really comes out of the gates blaring, ready to go, firing on all cylinders, because this, I think, is a great opener. I mean, it starts off with this very kind of almost hip-hop-esque groove from either Cy or Paul, which is then doubled up by the other drummer, giving it a kind of scrappy, loose feel. Like, they're not exactly like robotically linked with each other, so the beats are a bit off, a bit scrappy, but I think that adds to the charm. You know, they're not entirely synced up, but it still has that kind of hip-hop pump and kind of a groove to it, which is really nice, which is then obviously complemented by a great bass line from Steve Hanley. Like, the guy was in the Fall for nearly 20 years, he knows his way around a good bass line, and it really complements the groove on this to give it, again, that real nice sense of like hip-hop swagger, which I think is really cool. And I think it's something that the Fall did do sometimes, but something that I probably wish they would do more, and so tracks like this definitely fill that void. And moving on to the guitars, I think both Bramah and Greenway do a really good job, with Greenway offering a kind of typically rocking, blaring kind of guitar lead, which sounds really, really cool, while Martin offers a kind of more subtle wah-wah style funk guitar, which I think also works very nicely, which along with the groove and the bass almost gives it a kind of Manchester, dare I say, Stone Roses vibe, which I know that is kind of maybe a bit of a predictable comparison given that they're both part of like an integral Manchester music scene, but still, it does have a really cool sound to it, because the way not only that the groove is built upon, but also the way that the dueling guitars work really well together is great. And I feel like the, you know, it kind of has a subtly sinister but also dramatic air to it, and it's kind of subtly dark as well and shifting. It's really, really nice. And I think like Martin also does a very good job on vocals, because obviously Marky Smith's boots are quite some big boots to fill, but I feel like Martin does a decent job at kind of not so much trying to be MES, but trying to do his own thing and doing it very well, because these lyrics, a lot of Martin's lyrics are, I think, kind of deliberately inscrutable, but I feel like these lyrics kind of pay tribute to, I believe, a Middle English poet and kind of the revolutionary kind of air that he had about him. And a lot of these songs kind of discuss these kind of revolutionary rebel characters, and this is definitely the first instance of that. And also, you know, as somebody who studied English language, I can definitely kind of get behind some Middle English stuff, because we did that and I really enjoyed that side of it. So to kind of get those really deep literature references in there, I think is actually kind of cool. And throughout, his delivery is very commanding, very authoritative, very dramatic, has a real kind of sense of grandiosity to it, I think. And the way that he sings the melody on the chorus, while slightly understated, I do think works well in the grand scheme of the track. So for an opening track, this is about as good as you could get, like some really nice tight grooves, some funky bass lines, great dueling guitars, fantastic lyrics and vocal performances. It's about as good as you could get, as I say. Track number two is called But Willful I Am, and is definitely not something you'd get on a full record ever, I'm pretty sure, aside from maybe one track that they did in their entire career. But I do definitely like it for that reason, because it goes for a bit more of a, dare I say, power ballad type feel with a lot of the instrumentation on here. Like, yes, it's slightly cheesy with the kind of forlorn guitar notes and the cheesy organs, but I actually think they don't sound too bad, as a lot of them, including the bass line, actually have a really nice catchy feel to them that you can kind of hum along with, which is quite nice. And I feel like the drums do give it a certain sense of heft with the way that they're kind of pounding. Again, the benefits of having double drummers is definitely seen here, because it gives it a nice heft and a kind of a bass, a good bass to work off of, I think. And the extra flourishes at parts of the track where, you know, whether it's tambourines or shakers, are also quite nice. And I think the bits where they're kind of let loose a bit more on the fills are actually some of my favourite parts of the song. And even the cheesier elements like the guitar and the organs, because of the production, which I have to say is pretty good on this album, they still have a sense of grit to them, which is really nice, and a kind of sense of genuine kind of forlornness, I suppose would be the word. Like, they're not kind of cheesy and emotional power ballad type things that can just go so wrong. They do genuinely kind of carry an emotion, and maybe that's to do with Martin Bramah's vocal performance over the top of them, because this one is definitely more of a half sung vocal delivery from Martin rather than just a straight spoken word one. But despite it being still slightly deadpan, manages to carry a palpable emotion with the way that he sings the melodies on here, which I think is actually quite nice, because it seems to be a lot more of a personal track for Martin, kind of talking about how he maybe met up with an old lover, and he's kind of recounting the mistakes he made in a previous relationships and kind of wanting to, you know, make up for them, which I think is a very nice kind of earnest sentiment. I mean, granted, as I say, a lot of Martin's lyrics are very kind of inscrutable, so I could be getting something wrong, but I do appreciate them, as those lyrics that are kind of that personal, you'd never find on a full record, aside from tracks like Bill Is Dead, maybe, is the only one example I can think of. And this one does kind of feel a bit like Bill Is Dead sonically, but it's not to the point where I would say that it kind of sounds like The Fall. I mean, I know that sounds weird because I've just made a Fall comparison, but I appreciate the fact that this is not really something you would find on a Fall record, and I feel like for that reason I probably enjoy it even more than I already do. Because yes, the kind of some of the instrumental choices are a little bit cheesy, but I feel like the guitar lines and the bass and the organs still carry a palpable emotion. The drums give it some nice heft. Martin's vocal performance and his lyrics are very earnest. I like this one. The third track is also the third single, Dominus Ruinae, which I think is a track that I was a little bit mixed on first listening, but I think has grown on me a little bit, because instrumentally this one is kind of, it's a lot brighter than a lot of the tracks on the album, I would say, because Cyan Paul's double drum beat is very nice on this one. It's kind of, again, like on A and Bite, a kind of sloppy feel where it's not so machine-like, where they're playing completely in sync, but still has a very nice sense of groove and rhythm to it. And of course, you can always rely on Steve Hanley to hold down the fort on bass. And apparently this is one of the most complicated bass lines on the whole album, because apparently he's playing four octaves, but he does it like, and he makes it sound effortless, because it really does sound just like a really cool, relaxed, laid-back bass line on here, and it works very, very well. as does, I think, the dueling guitars from Martin and Pete again, which, while sounding fairly unremarkable, sonically speaking, like there's not a load of mad effects and pedals going on and what have you, but they do play some very nice riffs that have a kind of, again, bright, summery feel to them, which kind of make them sound, you know, dare I say, a bit charming. And I'd say this track is probably the most charming track on the whole album, if I had to be honest, because it just sounds quite optimistic, you know, in terms of the sound that it's going for. Like, some of the riffs just kind of give me that vibe of, like, you know, sat out on a summer's morning or afternoon or whatever, just kind of reminiscing about the good times. I don't know if I'm making any sense whatsoever to anybody watching this, but, you know, that's the vibe that it gives me. And I thought that the way they added to that with the subtle synthesizers in the chorus was quite nice. The one thing I would say, though, is that as much as I like the ideas on this track, and they do kind of, you know, they don't exactly wear out their welcome, the main riffs, like, they're still catchy, like, 3, 4, 5 minutes into it. But what I would say is that, you know, it's not the most dramatic, the most, like, completely shifting and weird and, like, world-altering track on this album. And so, you know, it can make the fact that it maybe runs a little bit low on ideas more obvious. Like, in the first 2.5 minutes, you've basically heard most of what this track has to offer you. And that's not to say it gets bad, but what I would say is that the incessant repetitions of the chorus beyond maybe like the 3 minute point do get a little bit annoying. Like, I wish they had a few more ideas, you know. I mean, Martin does a fairly good job on the lyrics, as I'll get into in a minute, but, you know, maybe pop in, like, another riff or a groove change or what have you, because, granted, the kind of topsy-turvy groove that they go with for most of this song is quite nice, and the way they kind of utilise a 5-4 time signature, I think, is also quite well done. But just, you know, a few more riffs, a few groove switches, maybe, you know, just keep it interesting, because this track, I think, is the longest on the album at 5.5 minutes. So, you know, I would appreciate maybe just a few changes here or there, but the riffs don't sound bad, so to speak. Just like, you know, I wish, particularly with the incessant repetitions of the chorus on the back end, that they maybe had a few more tricks up their sleeves on this one, but still. And as I say, Martin does a decent job on this song vocally, because I think he is able to switch quite effectively from the more kind of half-sung spoken vocals in the verses to the sung choruses, and the various different subtle inflection changes throughout the song are quite nice. Again, it adds to that sense of charm with some of his vocal deliveries, and I think the kind of shouted dramatic delivery towards the back end is quite nice as well. Although I do think that his weird kind of shouted delivery of the chorus also on the back end does ring to me as a little bit irritating, but I'd say for the most part, you know, he's able to vary up his vocal delivery enough to keep things interesting, but also having some quite nice lyrics as well. Because they seem to be kind of poking at the political establishment for the most part. I mean, there's some lyrics that don't quite fit into that, like, you know, when he says, "Do you love her?" whatever that means. Like, so maybe I'm missing something, and I probably am, but most of the track seems to be kind of poking at the political establishment, but not in a way that kind of seems out to be rebellious or edgy, but rather in a way that is kind of, you know, a bit tongue-in-cheek, if you like, a bit kind of, you know, kind of just like sticking two fingers up at them and just kind of making fun of them, which is kind of in a way reflected by the title of the track, Dominus Ruinae, which means Lord of the Ruins, in a way, kind of a facetious comment, maybe, being like, oh, you know, you rule over the ruins because you've ruined it or whatever. You know, I think if that's what they're going for, it was quite well done. And it was also helped by the other various references to things like, you know, dames and saints and cabinet secretaries and stuff like that. So it definitely carries the theme well. So, you know, it's got some nice riffs and rhythms throughout this track, for sure. A decent vocal performance for the most part. Some entertaining lyrics. A cool bass line. I think I've already mentioned the rhythms. But I do think that maybe, given it's 5.5 minutes, it could have maybe done with a bit more structural variation for my taste. But what it's got already really isn't too bad. I just wish it was a bit more kind of multifaceted, if you like. The track at the halfway point is the lead single, Harlequin Duke, and it's absolutely brilliant. I don't really know what I can say about this song other than it is brilliant, because instrumentally, this thing for me is untouchable. Like, the star of the show, I think, is kind of Steve Hanley's really nice, dirty, grinding, belligerent bass line. I think it might also be doubled up by a guitar line. But I think, actually, if I remember correctly, this track was written or based off a riff written by Pete Greenway. So I think this might be Greenway's doing. If so, well done, Pete. But the way Steve performs that bass line that is eventually doubled up with the guitar line is just super cool, really laid back, but also has a real dirt and a belligerence to it, which is super cool. And I feel like the way the drums are doubled up is really cool as well. They have a really nice kind of big, huge grandiosity to them, which is really nice, and definitely shows the benefit of having a double drummer lineup where you get drum sounds that are this huge and this massive and this grand. It sounds amazing, as does the rest of the instrumentation, because the way they utilise some really nice forlorn organ progressions is also very, very nice, because that's the first thing that instantly hits you out of the gate, is like these really nice grand but slightly forlorn organs. They sound really, really cool, and I feel like they do add to the generally sinister vibe the track has going for it, because this track is very grand and dramatic, but also very sinister and kind of subtly off-putting as well, and it's kind of constantly shifting and evolving, because not only have you got the groove and the organs and the bass working fantastic, but also there's a load of really weird and different guitar lines going throughout this song, whether it's the kind of wiry ones that go throughout the intro, or the kind of more distorted grand ones in the chorus maybe, or some of the more kind of psychedelic and even bluesy ones at points that go throughout maybe the verse extension, which I believe are from Greenway, because they do sound like some classic Greenway riffs, and they work absolutely brilliantly for my money. And as I was going to say, the way that they shift from these really kind of dark, foreboding verses into these really kind of grand, dramatic, kind of climactic chorus sections is also very, very nice. Like, it's not the most varied progressive track in the world, but they just kind of make these subtle shifts and changes, like I maybe wanted them to do on Dominus Rumine, where there's just enough stuff like coming in and out at various points to keep it interesting throughout. And I feel like Martin also does a very good job on the lyrical and vocal end, because vocally he has this very kind of dramatic, kind of authoritative, commanding delivery on this one, as if he's like delivering a sermon or something. I suppose it's got that kind of real grand presentation to it, which is really cool, as if he's kind of like addressing his subjects, kind of telling this story of a bit of a macabre character, if you like, doing a dance against death. And there's talk about, like, you know, sardonic scrambling, cocaine on the doorbell, electromatic convulsions, a necklace of gouged out eyes, swollen faces. It's a really deep, dark, kind of very novelistic character portrayal that he gives in the lyrics, which I think is really cool, because it adds a sense of, like, it is a slightly otherworldly, not only with the way the instrumentation is playing in the background, which sound fantastic, but also just the way that Martin's able to conjure up this character that feels so kind of macabre and so odd and so otherworldly, I think is very, very well done. Some people thought that it was maybe a tribute to Smith, which I don't think is true all the way through, although I do think there is a bit of a touching ode to Smith where Martin goes, you know, maybe our bingo master has returned, which I think is actually quite a touching, you know, little tribute for those in the know, you know what I mean? So I think the lyrics are very well done, the vocals are really commanding, really authoritative, and fit the track perfectly for my money, and the really nice dramatic, shifting, bluesy, psychedelic, wiry, post-punk instrumental sounds great. I mean, I did say when I first heard this song that it sounds very, very, very like The Fall, and I was kind of disappointed that this track sounded as much like The Fall as it did, but actually on reflection, I think I can see where it came from, because a lot of the drums, and particularly the guitar lines, I think really kind of spoke to me as being kind of similar to late era Fall in particular, but I feel like it's the kind of grandiosity of this track and the kind of foreboding, almost kind of apocalyptic feel that you get from this song is something that I don't think you would get in The Fall a lot of the time, and so for me, it's definitely one of the standouts on the album, without a shadow of a doubt. The track that follows is the second single, called Magic Sound, and this one is probably my least favourite on the album, just because, like, I don't hate all of it, but it definitely pales into comparison to what's here already, because I feel like there are bits of this song that work well. Like, for me, I really like the nice doubled up stomping drum sound from Simon Paul yet again, and I feel like the bass has a kind of, you know, jolly, catchy quality to it. It's slightly lolloping as well. As you know, it's quite catchy and quite hummable and quite nice. And I think that the kind of touches of cheesy organs that go throughout parts of the song, as cheesy as they are, I do think are actually quite enjoyable. But the thing that you realise about this song, right, you've got the stomping drum beat and the bass line, which work nicely, you know, a good pairing. But then when the guitar line is put on top of it, what you realise is that this basically sounds like what would happen if The Fall tried to, like, cover the Fratellis or, like, interpolate Park Life or something. Like, admittedly, the guitar riff has a bit more edge than that kind of typical sound, but it's, like, the same uppity kind of indie guitar riff, again, with a bit more edge, the same stomping drum beat and lolloping bass line, for 5 straight minutes. Like, there's basically no variation, apart from the organs that pop in at various points in the chorus, which admittedly are kind of enjoyable. There's really no change to this song, so it's just the same riffs and grooves over and over and over and over again, and it does get quite annoying after a while, to be honest with you. Like, as I've said, the rhythm section isn't bad, but it just gets, like, especially with the melodies that are on it, it just gets really inane, and I don't think Martin's vocal performance really helps with that either, because it's definitely a lot more reserved than previous tracks and doesn't really have that same character going for it, if you like. There's not really a lot of character coming through in the vocal performance, and I think that the constant inane repetitions of the chorus, like on Dominus Ruminae, but I think a bit worse, Dominus Ruinae rather, because Dominus Ruinae kind of suffered from a problem where, like, the chorus, and I didn't actually touch on this in the segment, where the chorus on Dominus Ruinae could sound kind of dirge-like with the way they were singing it, and this one, I think, is arguably even more annoying, because it's just the same refrain of, like, I finally found the magic sound, I finally found the magic sound, I finally found, and it just goes over and over and over, and it gets very, very annoying quite quickly. And to be fair, the fact that they basically do nothing but repeat this chorus for the last, like, 2 minutes of the song really makes it grate on your skull a little bit. And the way they utilise group vocals certainly doesn't help. And to be fair, the lyrics aren't even doing much of interest. Like, there are the odd turns of phrase on this song, like Bay City Pistols, that I think are quite entertaining. But the general gist of this song seems to be discussing, like, the kind of, you know, the lightning in a bottle moment where a band finds their sound, you know, which I'm sure is a really cool kind of sensation and could make for quite an interesting set of lyrics. But the way that Martin does it on this song just feels very, like, I mean, there are some, like, odd, weird turns of phrase and, like, esoteric vocabulary that kind of, you know, seem definitely in his wheelhouse. But for the most part, this song kind of sounds like a song you would get on, like, a kids' TV show about budding musicians, you know, like, oh, we found our sound, guys, hooray, I finally found, like, it just sounds, I don't know where I'm going with that comparison, but it sounds really cheesy and kind of, again, inane after a while. So I'd say that this track, it's not all bad. Again, the rhythm section, I think, holds it down pretty well. But, you know, for the most part, I feel like it's just, like, the problems that previous tracks like Dominus Ruinae might have had with the kind of very sort of structurally one note thing and kind of, you know, not really having a lot going on, you know, not a lot of changes. This one suffers from those problems, like, fivefold, because, like, again, some of the ideas are all right and the lyrical concept in concept isn't actually too bad, but in execution it just gets kind of annoying. Track number 6 is called Minerva Disrobed and is another kind of sonic left turn on this album, as this one I feel like it goes for a bit of a darker sound palette, but I'll get into that, but it does work very well. To start with the drums, I feel like, again, like many tracks on this album have before, it really shows the benefit of having a double drummer lineup, but this one I feel particularly shows that benefit, because a lot of the time on this album, Cy and Paul have kind of been playing in unison, if you like, so not really playing beats that are too dissimilar from each other, whereas this one, they are kind of playing two separate composite parts that come together into actually quite a cool drum sound, because on one, you've got one of them playing kind of a semi-snappy kind of metallic hip-hop beat on one side, and then the other person playing a kind of cascading tom beat over top of it, which gives it a really cool momentum and a slightly kind of sinister feel almost to it, especially when the melodies come in, because the guitars have that same kind of complement of, like, funky and blaring that they did on maybe the opening track, but done with a definitely a more gothic and sinister edge this time around. There's a lot of Greenway's melodies in particular are, like, really sour and very dark and, again, slightly sinister and gothic, which work very well, as does Steve Hanley's bass, which I think adds to that, you know, that sense of gothic with those same kind of dark progressions, but with that kind of grinding belligerence that you want from a really nice bass line, which I think, again, along with the drums, gives it a really nice kind of heft that it needs, and adds to that sense of drama in that same way, I suppose. And admittedly, the kind of additions of cheesy, like, evil organs throughout the song would sound awful on paper, but I do think actually work quite well in practice, because I feel like because you've got the guitars playing this really kind of forlorn, dramatic, gothic thing, and the bass doubling onto it, how do you kind of take that idea even further? Well, you add some organs to it, and they're not like so like cheesy Dracula like mwahaha organs, but they are kind of more subtle, but do kind of have a kind of air of unease about them, which is very nice. And I feel like Martin also kind of contributes to this in a way on the vocal end, because he has the same kind of, you know, foreboding narration that he did on Harlequin, but maybe in a more reserved capacity this time around, which if anything adds more to that sense of unease that was here already. But because he's kind of going for a more reserved delivery rather than like shouting or kind of dramatically prophesizing, it kind of adds to that sense of fear and kind of oddity that this song plays with very nicely. Because the lyrics here are kind of like Ian Bite, kind of, you know, or Harlequin maybe, discussing a kind of rebellious, a free-thinking kind of figure. Because Martin's lyrics are the way they are, they could be one of two things. A, I read it as kind of the story of this very vivid, uncompromising, bold, like, female artist character, like, determined to measure up to the work of her male counterparts and gain the respect of her male counterparts, but refusing to compromise artistically, which I think on its own would be a very kind of cool character portrayal that Martin puts across. Or it could be a reference to Minerva, who I think is the Greek goddess of wisdom and also the patron saint of many artistic institutions, kind of how her overriding influence makes artists do their best work. Either way, it's a very nice set of lyrics, and one that not only adds to the sense of like sinisterness and like foreboding in the instrumental, but also again adds that kind of, you know, who doesn't love a bit of Greek mythology? I know I do. So it kind of adds to that sense of like, I want to say intellectualism that a lot of Martin's lyrics and this album I think has, but that sounds a bit wanky. But like it does, it adds to a very cool instrumental by giving a very cool kind of a bit out of left field lyrical sentiment that works with it very well. I'm not sure if I'm making any sense here, but hopefully I am. So yeah, you've got a really nice, cool, dramatic, dark, gothic, sinister instrumental, you know, complemented by some fantastic lyrics, very descriptive, very vivid, very bold, and also a more reserved vocal performance, but one that puts across that character in a very compelling way. So it ticks every box for me. The penultimate track is There's More, and I feel like is basically the nth degree of what happens when you go, okay, let's just make some noise. Because this one definitely is maybe the most simplistic track musically on this album, but the intensity that it carries off is absolutely incredible. Like, again, it feels like this track's modus operandi was just like, go, 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 noise, noise, noise. And it's definitely the heaviest track on the album, and I think works because of it. Because as Paul Hanley said, again, on the Twitter listening party, I'll pull up the screenshot, like, you know, cool drum grooves and all that stuff, like 5/4s and waltzes and hip hop and stuff and all that, that's good. But like, you know, you can't get much better than like two people whacking seven bells out of their kit in unison. And that is basically what Paul and Cy do on this album, just constantly banging and bashing on their drums. And it's like a really cathartic release. It sounds really cool, almost tribal in a way, I suppose. And the way that Martin and Pete add to this with these walls of like really blaring guitars, just non-stop, really kind of like really noisy, really blaring, really just like, you know, it gets that sense of intensity across, as does Steve's bass playing, which as always sounds super belligerent. And I think it also has a sense of intensity to it as well, because a lot of Steve's bass lines are like effortlessly cool, but you can kind of hear on this track that he's just really kind of like pulling at it just to get the most belligerent, loud sound he possibly can out of it. And that I feel like is a lot of the appeal of this track, is it's just intensity in musical form. And as basic as it might be in terms of structure, because it is basically just the same bashing grooves and guitars and riffs over and over for 5 minutes, but they add to that sense of intensity. So like, you think the song starts intense because everything's banging and bashing and noisy and what have you, but then you get to the end of the track and it's even more noisy, even more bashing, even more cathartic than it already was. So it just kind of constantly builds and builds and builds in intensity until it's just this massive wall of belligerent noise, like a monster stomping through a city. It sounds incredible. And I feel like Martin's vocal delivery also does a lot to aid that, because he does a lot of that kind of foreboding narration that he's done on previous tracks, but will often just have like a random shouted passage on the chorus, particularly on the chorus when he's like, "There's more!" And he just completely belts that out. Again, it just adds more and more and more to that sense of like that intensity and grandiosity that the track has, which is really, really cool. Although the lyrics on this one are completely inscrutable to me. Like, to me, they seem to be kind of detailing the escapades of various like odd characters, including like a career criminal and like a supernaturally obsessed poet. But, and like, you know, I have no idea what this song is talking about lyrically, but the turns of phrase and the vividity with which he puts across these characters is enough to keep me interested. And the turns of phrase about like golden horseshoes and decapitated heads and like Italian speaking pirates and like drunk vampires and shit like that, I've got no idea what he's talking about, but my god, is it entertaining. And I feel like just that is the thing with this track, is like, you don't have to understand what's going on, it doesn't have to be the most complex thing ever, but as long as you've got conviction in your vocal delivery, you're saying some cool sounding stuff, the instrumental's going hell for leather, really, what more do you need? And the final track is Turning of the Years, and I think is another real highlight for me. Like, I know that this album is only 8 songs long, but it has been chock full of highlights, and this is certainly one of them. Because the way the intro starts off with the very uppity drum beat and guitar riff, it did remind me of a lot of When the Fall would do a kind of western or rockabilly type track, which is not something I'm normally a fan of. Like, tracks like Grounds Boy or Cowboy George or things like that, they're not really my favourites. Amarato would be an example as well. But this one, I feel like they do it quite well, because not only is the guitar riff really catchy, but the groove has a nice momentum to it. And particularly, I think the way that Pete and Martin double up that same guitar riff gives it, it just makes the riff sound cooler. I don't know if that makes any sense, but like the way they, the way they double it up makes the riff sound a bit less flimsy, which I think is what a lot of the western sounding tracks in the Falls canon did kind of suffer from. Because you've got the one sole guitar line going, it did tend to sound a little bit flimsy, but the way they double it up I think is really cool. And I think as well, as always, Steve's bass playing, effortless, immaculate, grooving, fits perfectly with the drum beat to give it a really kind of uppity bouncing feel, but not in a kind of annoying way, but just in a slightly reserved, but like, you know, you can bop along with it as much as you like. So, you know, Steve's bass playing, tick, the drums, tick, guitars, tick. And I would say that as well, the more forlorn guitar progressions in the chorus are also very well done and kind of add to a palpable emotion that the track has generally, which I think is very well done on an instrumental and vocal front, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Although the one thing I would say is that for some reason at points in the track, particularly in the chorus, the guitars on the right channel seem to just like cut out at random points for seemingly no reason at all and then cut back in. I don't know if it was intentional or just like a mixing mistake, but it sounds very odd. But aside from that one little blemish, this track instrumentally, it takes something that would normally be in the Falls repertoire that I wouldn't really be a fan of too much and makes me a fan of it really, which I think is very impressive. I feel like this track's strengths are bolstered even more by Martin's vocal and lyrical contributions, because this track, like But Willful I Am, is definitely more of a personal track for Martin, it seems like. And so I think the way he tackles it is done very well here. Like, not only is his more kind of reserved, measured delivery used very well as a kind of, it's very contemplative as well, the way, like, thinking back on his life events and delivering them with a conviction and again a vividity which I think is very, very compelling. And I feel like the lyrics are also very touching, kind of talk about how in the wake of a friend's death he kind of feels like the need to reconnect with old friends who he maybe feels guilty he disconnected with in the wake of like trying to find fame as a musician, maybe, which is how I read it. And some of the imagery does kind of hit you hard, like, you know, I tried to put the breath back into him when he was dead, you know, that sense of desperation over the loss of a loved one or a friend is actually very, very nicely done. And the way that he kind of chronicles that sense of like maybe regret or loss throughout the various lyrics in the song is also very well done. So again, it's another emotional moment, and I don't think it's something you would ever get on a Fall album, but I feel like it's done fantastically. Like, the instrumental is brilliant, I feel like the way they duel the guitars is very nice, the groove is basically untouchable, and Martin's vocal performance and lyrics are some of the most touching I think I've ever heard from him. Like, this album obviously hasn't been kind of like the most emotional album ever, but it really ends the album off with a nice, really impactful punch, which is very, very well done, I think, and is a great closer overall. So, what did I think of the brand new self-titled album from House of All? Well, I don't think I really need to say much about this track. Like, my main concern was, with this album, can they kind of come out of the shadow of the fall and really make something that I could say is entirely their own? And to be honest, I think they have done that. Like, yes, there are a few riffs and grooves that maybe feel like they're very reminiscent of past fall stuff, but I feel like, for the most part, they've done something that is very original and is very compelling. Like, obviously, not every track on this is a complete hit, maybe because the linear structure of it isn't really my thing, or they don't have the ideas to really justify the runtime, or maybe some of the lyrics are a little bit too inscrutable to really make sense to me, or maybe some of the vocal performances are a little bit under-delivered, but those are like very, very rare occurrences on what I think is overall a very, very strong album, because you've got four or five musicians at the top of their game just making music that is fantastic. And apparently they really banged this out really quickly. Like, they went into the studio with basically no ideas and just banged out an album, and to say that it is of this quality really speaks to the acumen of the people involved, because my god, the riffs on this thing, the grooves on this thing, the lyrics on this thing, the vocals for the most part are incredible. And I think it's a shame that they'll never escape the fall comparisons, because I really think they've done something that is, while it may have influences from kind of post-punk and Manchester and those kind of adjacent scenes, is really something that I find to be very compelling, but also very uniquely them, because it kind of, I suppose it kind of curates their best influences and delivers something that is very, very enjoyable at the end of the day. So I'd say, you know, if you're a fall fan, buy this, listen to it, it's great. But I'd say just also, if you're a fan of like raw, gritty, belligerent, like, you know, post-punky rock music with an esoteric edge, give this album a go, because I think as far as this year is concerned, I don't know if you'll find something that's too much better. Like, granted, it's not a perfect album, again, but it does a hell of a lot right. And really, like, if they ever do a second album, you know I'll be there on release day, because these guys are very competent musicians, and, you know, I feel like The Fall has been kind of a good, you know, testing ground for them. And so the fact that they're able to kind of come together as, like, The Fall Avengers and produce something of this quality, to be honest, I don't know why I'm that surprised. So if I have to give a score, I'm thinking like a strong 7, decent 8. Like, it was really, really good. So I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do consider liking and subscribing. It would really mean a lot to me. I don't really have a lot to say. I'm really trying to grind out videos at the moment, so I'll be filming another video after this today, and like a load of other videos in the coming days. So you should just get video after video after video, as I said in the previous one. But I suppose the major announcement from me is that the Forensic Record Society, or Not So Forensic Record Society, will be back in the next couple of weeks, hopefully within the next 3 weeks, hopefully before the end of May is what I'll say, just as the insurance choice, because you know, I've missed doing it, and I've kind of, we did have a guest spot lined up, but I suppose in a way it's kind of fallen through. It should still come out, but there's, I made a bit of a whoops with that one, which you'll see when the episode comes out, which was actually quite funny. But, you know, we've been trying to get it out, and, you know, for various reasons it just kind of hasn't worked. But, you know, we finally got to a point where, you know, me and Callagher want to do it again. I really miss doing it, and I, you know, I don't know if he does, but I know I have a good time while doing it, and I hope he does as well. And I just hope that we have the kind of same, you know, ability to banter that we did 6-7 months ago. And I think, like, the playlists that are coming up on this new one, at least from my perspective, I can tell you, are some corkers. So, you know, I just hope that when it does come out, you'll enjoy it. I hope that I'll enjoy it as much as I remember enjoying it. You know, I just hope it's a decent video. I mean, I don't see no reason why it should be. Like, it's one of my favourite series to do, and I'm glad, in a way, to have it back. But, you know, I just hope it's as good as it has been in the past. So, you know, keep your eyes peeled for that, and until next time, I'll see you all later.